good morning, everybody. Welcome you to this service of worship today. Special welcome to those of you who are visiting with us. We're so glad that you are able to join us today. Pray a special blessing for you, that the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the living God will reveal himself in some way to you and bring a blessing to your life. Everything that we do here at Parker's Cove by way of ministry, including our Sunday morning services, is all really to express worship, gratitude, thankfulness, praise to our God who sent his one and only Son, who laid down his life and did so that we might be forgiven of our sins. And of course, God raised him from the dead. He is indeed the great I Am. And so we come to worship him today. I'm going to let you remain seated as we sing our opening song, but don't get too comfortable. We are going to ask you to stand or invite you to stand for a couple of songs today. The Apostle Paul, in writing to the church at Galatia, described his life this way, and this ought to be a description for you and I as well. He said, "I am crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me, and the life I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." And one of the ways that we can live our life by faith is to be subject to his lordship and say, "Lord, wherever you lead and however you lead in my life, I will follow you." So we're going to do an old hymn today called "Where He Leads, I Follow." Sweet are the promises, kind is the word, dearer far than any message man ever heard. Pure was the mind of Christ, sinless I see. He the great example is and pattern for me. Where he leads, I'll follow, follow all the way. I'll follow, follow Jesus every day. Now, raise your hand if you have never heard this song before. I had a feeling, because we came in to run through a couple of songs this morning, and Marilyn and Sherwin said they'd never heard it before. But you know, you got to cut them some slack, because they're just young people. I thought, oh, well, hopefully some of the over 50 bunch will know this one, and obviously you don't. So we're teaching you a new song. It's an old song, folks, but it's a great song that calls us to pledge our lives to follow the Lord. Let's try the next verse. Sweet is the tender love Jesus has shown, sweeter far than any love that mortals have known. Kind to the erring one, faithful is he. He the great example is and pattern for me. Where he leads, I'll follow, follow all the way. Where he leads, I'll follow, follow Jesus every day. One more verse. List to his loving words, come unto me. Weary, heavy laden, there is sweet rest for thee. Trust in his promises, faithful and sure. Lean upon the Savior and your soul is secure. Where he leads, I'll follow, follow all the way. Where he leads, I'll follow, follow Jesus every day. Sing that one last time. Where he leads, I'll follow, follow all the way. Where he leads, I'll follow, follow Jesus every day. open with a word of prayer. Lord, we're glad to be here today. We are a blessed people to belong to you, the God of heaven and earth, to have experienced your love and your mercy through Jesus, who took upon himself our guilt and our sin, and he paid the great debt that we all owed that separated us from you. But by your grace, we who have put our faith and our trust in you and turned to your Son and believed in him, we have this precious gift of forgiveness, of salvation, and we share the hope of eternal life. We come to celebrate that once more today, and I pray that our hearts will in every possible way, Lord, just be drawn heavenward, that it would be your voice that we hear most of all as your Spirit speaks to us and as your word is shared. We pray that you will find within us as you examine our hearts, and you do that each and every moment of every day. Lord, may you find that within us is a desire always and consistently to follow you. To that end, I ask for your blessing upon our time together and upon each one who has come into this place, and receive our praise in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Colin, if you want to come and run through a couple of announcements, we'll invite you, as Colin's coming, to just go ahead and look through your bulletin at some of the regular things that are happening, but Colin has a couple of additional things to bring to our attention.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you all. First off, I just want to say thanks again for your continued prayers as I'm recovering from my surgery a couple weeks ago. Just a quick update, I guess. Met with the surgeon on Thursday. He's very happy with the way things are settling in. I meet with him again in 6 weeks, but at this stage, we're looking way better than we were before, so thank you for continuing to pray for Vashti as she has to put up with me. Just a handful of announcements this week. I won't highlight anything that you guys don't already have a good idea about. Again, you guys have your bulletin, so you know what's going on this week. I just want to point out two things. One, just a little update on how day camp is progressing. Things are looking great. We have almost hit our limit for kids registered, so it's really exciting to know that we have so many that are going to be here. At this point, we're just putting everything together, getting ready for the 16th, which is only 2 weeks from now, which is really exciting. For those of you who are in this room and for those in the cafe, I do have a clipboard here at the back of the sanctuary. We just need to get a few things together, and one of those things is getting some snacks for the afternoons. We do provide a snack in the morning and in the afternoons. The morning snack is already looked after, but we would like you guys to partner with us for the afternoon snack. So there's a clipboard back there. We're looking for some baked goods and some goodies for the afternoons. There's a specified amount. We're looking for basically 4 dozen of each thing. So if you want to sign up to cook a dozen chocolate chip cookies or do a dozen Rice Krispie squares, just go ahead and fill your name on the clipboard back there, and that would be awesome. Aside from that, I do just want to update everybody. If you look in your bulletin, under our under our weekly update, there's a little thing called the Parker's Cove Baptist Church walking track update. I'll let you guys read all that, but what I want to let everybody here know is that we've received a grant from the government to put in a community walking track out in the field. So I believe Scotty McIntosh is going to be doing that, but we're going to be receiving in a grant $3,074.29 to look after that. That covers just about 75% of the overall cost for this project. And we're still looking to complete that. We're required to receive that grant. We have to contribute a sign, which is $100, a picnic table, which is $299, a bench, which is $182.21, and we're looking for 2 people who would be willing to donate 8 hours of helping out. What that's going to look like, it doesn't even have to be 2 people for 8 hours. If you can do maybe an hour or two here or there. If you have some free time over the next number of weeks, this will likely take place after day camp, so you have some time to kind of look at what your schedule will allow. But go ahead and call Gina, her number's right there, so we can go ahead and get this project in motion. But we've received grants before for things that have been a benefit to the community, like our playground outside. I know when I'm working here in the building, it's so cool to see how many families in the course of a day will come up to use the facilities that we have available for the community. So this is just another way that we can get some folks on the property through the course of the week, and we're looking forward to seeing how God is going to use that ministry. So that's all I have off the top of my head. You guys have a good week.
All right, thanks, Colin. there's a medley of songs, and I was trying to remember if we even did this in 2020 because we weren't here a whole lot. So it might have been a couple of years since we did this, but this is a little medley of songs that have kind of a Hebrew flavor to them, and so we've mixed them in. I left one of them out today because it's quite a lengthy medley, but we're going to do three of them together, and so our roots are in the nation of Israel. Our Savior was born to the nation of Israel, and so about once a year, I kind of like to incorporate these songs just as something a little bit different. So I'll invite you to stand. And the medley is a little chorus. The first one is "The Trees of the Field," and based on Isaiah 55:12. And then "Jehovah Jireh" is the second one, and the last one is "Awake, O Israel." These are songs that kind of at the core remind us of the promises that God made to his chosen people, that there were times of hardship and conflict and misery in their lives, but he had great and wonderful plans for their future. And of course, that future is really in the coming of his son and what we have available through faith in the Lord Jesus. So let's give these songs a try. So everybody take a deep breath, because you're going to need it. Shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will break forth before you. There'll be shouts of joy, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands while you go out with joy. All right, let's try that one more time. You shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will break forth before you. There'll be shouts of joy, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands while you go out with joy. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me, for me, for me. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me. Sing that again. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me, for me, for me. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me. And my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches in glory. He will give his angels charge over me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me, for me, for me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me. Let's sing through that one more time. Jehovah Jireh,
My provider is grace is sufficient for me, for me, for me, Jehovah Jireh. My provider is grace is sufficient for me, and my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches in glory. He will give his angels charge over me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me, for me, for me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me. Awake, O Israel, put off thy slumber, for the truth shall set you free. For out of Zion comes thy deliverer in the year of Jubilee. Oh, hallelujah! Oh, hallelujah! Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! Oh, hallelujah! Oh, hallelujah! Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! Oh, in the furnace of much affliction, I have chosen thee, behold. And so for iron, I'll give thee silver, and for brass, I'll give thee gold. Thou art my chosen, for I have sought thee. Thou art graven on my hands, and I will gather all those that gathered, they shall come back to their land. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah, oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the Lord. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands while you go out with joy. While you go out with joy.
All right, you can be seated. Hey, we'll pick that up next time. You're absolutely right. We should do a little. All right. Lots of energy in that. Phew-wee. I'm sorry. I know I've got water and you don't, but I just need a little help here. All right. At this time, we're going to go ahead and dismiss the children for their junior church time. And so, young ones, you can go, and there's something planned for you. So, all right. And for the big kids who are staying, we're going to do one more song. I hope you know this one. This is another old hymn, and this is our prayer song today. It ties in very much to the opening song of, just surrendering ourselves and saying, Lord, however you lead, wherever you lead, I'm determined and I'm decided that I'm going to follow you. And this is just another yielding to the Lord. It's the old hymn, Have Thine Own Way.
Have thine own way. the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. As in thy presence, humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway. Fill with thy spirit till all shall see Christ only, always living in me. Fill with thy spirit till all shall see Christ only, always living in me.
All right, thanks, guys. Thank you, gentlemen and lady. That would be the more appropriate thing to say. All right, before we get into the Word of God, let's have a word of prayer together. Lord, you who search our hearts and know our thoughts. God, that song just echoes that word from the psalmist. Search me, O God, and know my heart today. And you do indeed know our hearts today. You know where we are in keeping and in line with your word, and in places where we are adrift and wandering and drawn into the things of the world. But Lord, we are first of all so thankful for your grace and your forgiveness, for the assurance of knowing that you love us for who we are and where we are, and all the past things that were a part of our life before we came to know Jesus are all washed away. They've been pardoned. But you also pardon us along the way as we walk in relationship with you. And as you do your sanctifying work in us, and you move and teach and instruct and convict by your Spirit, Lord, I pray that our hearts will, from our hearts, will be willing to say to you, Lord, have your own way. We want to be in the sweetest and closest communion with you. We know that your communion with us doesn't end, but sometimes, again, we get adrift in some ways where our communion with you is not what it should be. But Lord, we are just pledging ourselves anew today as we come into this place, first and foremost to remember who you are and to reflect on and to recall the salvation that you have provided for us, and that you are the provider of every need for our lives each and every day, and that we need to keep our trust ever in you. And so, Lord, we do that together, and we also, I hope on behalf of everyone in the congregation, just pledge, Lord, that we are ready to hear what you have to say to us today from your word, that it might come to us clearly and with understanding with the help of your Spirit, that we might know the values and the truths that you hold and have imparted to us in the pages of Scripture and that have been brought to us in person by your Son and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we invite you to speak today. We open our ears and our eyes again because we have that desire, that ambition, O God, to be a people who are ever pleasing to you. Father, I'm grateful for each one who has made this morning gathering part of their routine and part of their desire. And Father, I thank you for every heart and every home that's represented here, where I know you are Lord, and your salvation has met those families. And they give testimony, not only by their being here, but by the walk that they walk, by the way that they speak. They are testifying that there are people whose trust is in the Lord, and they're looking to be pleasing to you. So I do ask that you would bless each home represented here today. Father, I thank you for the privilege of the calling that is ours, not only to salvation, but to service for you. Your church is designed with such diversity of people, and even in the distribution of the gifts and talents that you give, you do so in such a way whereby we can all contribute in some way to the mission that you have given to us, not only to be encouraging to one another through fellowship, but also in testifying to the truth of the gospel to those who need to hear it. And so, God, I thank you for the diversity of abilities and talents you have dispersed in this particular congregation and the years of faithful ministry that has taken place here. Lord, we want to see another generation come along and devote their hearts and their lives to service for the Lord. We want to see more and more people have hearts that the gospel gets a hold of, that the Spirit comes and indwells their lives, who have a passion for you, who have a desire for the knowledge of Scripture, who desire to be close to Jesus, and who desire to share their faith with other people. And so, Father, we would always and continually pray for our ministry, for our lives individually, and for our ministries, that these would be not only formulated but carried out in a way that would accomplish those things, because we are not here to be a light to ourselves but to this broader community. And in that, I would also pray for those in our community who don't know the Lord. Lord, and those are many. Some have had glimpses of your kindness and your mercy. They've had a taste of the truths of Scripture, perhaps through a Sunday school program or an Awana program or something, but today their interest is gone and they've drifted off. Father, we want to pray for them that maybe something that they've heard from you in the past might awaken in their hearts, and that they would hear that in the light of their circumstances and recall the name of the Lord and the goodness of the Lord and the gospel of the Lord, and that they might be drawn back to you. So we ask you to work in their lives. Father, for those who are oblivious to you even existing, Father, we pray that you would do a work as only you can do by the power of your Spirit, and you would move in their lives to awaken in them a desire to find something more that gives hope and purpose and life. Father, I pray for them that they would rub shoulders with one of your people and that your people would be ready to love on them and bring salt and light into their lives, that they too might come out of the darkness and come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior and share the hope that we celebrate and sometimes take for granted. Father, our desire is to have a ministry that sees lives changed for Jesus. If we're not doing that, then something's amiss. And so, Father, continue to lead our various ministries. We pray even now for our day camp ministry that's coming along. Father, I pray for the workers who have committed to that. I pray for the children who will be coming. I pray for the broader influence on families in our community. Lord, that in every conceivable way, the name of Jesus would resound in the ears and in the hearts of these children and on into these homes. And so, Father, bring together the details that Colin and the others are trying to bring together right now, and let your blessing in every way fall upon that particular ministry. Father, we pray for your continued care and grace and healing for those who are dealing with physical adversities in their lives. We certainly continue to pray for Colin. We're thankful for the progress and just pray that you would continue to bring healing to his body. We rejoice with Nathaniel being home, as we announced last week, and just pray for his ongoing recovery and renewal of strength. We pray for families who are hurting from the loss of loved ones. We think of the Wade family today. Pray for much grace and much help there. Father, for others who are battling various things, Lord, especially among your children, Lord, let them sense your presence. Let them recall the promises of your word, including the promise that you will never leave them nor forsake them, and they stand, no matter what happens, to inherit the promises that you have made to them through Jesus. And so, Lord, just wrap your arms around them today. And Lord, for the privilege of being able to share your word, I thank you and I pray that your spirit would in every way provide wisdom, counsel and strength and discernment, and just in every way govern what is shared today, that we might just come away with clarity as to what Jesus has to say about what is clearly a sensitive issue for some. So lead us in your word by your spirit, in Jesus' name. Just before we get into our next message from the Sermon on the Mount, I want to just say this. A couple of folks have made some inquiry about this idea that we have been sharing in this particular series about being kingdom people, living by kingdom values, being even a kingdom of people. All we really are saying there is another way of saying that we're disciples of Jesus. Jesus is Lord. We are and teacher and master. We are the disciples. We learn from him. Just put another way, we're saying he's the king. We are the subjects. We learn from him and we live out the values and pursue the attitudes that are in keeping with what it means to be attached to and belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I hope that we haven't created any confusion for you. I went back on the internet just to see when our inaugural message, our introductory message for this particular series was. It was on May the 2nd. We weren't meeting in the building at that time, but we did post that particular message to YouTube. So if you want to go to the church YouTube page and endure listening to me share that message again, Lord bless you. By all means, do that. But that particular message was where we kind of laid down the foundations for this idea of being kingdom people. And when Jesus is sharing the Sermon on the Mount, he's really presenting those attitudes and those precepts and that kind of conduct that is in keeping with someone who belongs to the kingdom of heaven. All right? So that's all I'll say about that for this morning. All right, let's turn on my end of these things. All right, so we are in Matthew chapter 5. If you were with us last Sunday, we looked at what Jesus had to say about the command, you shall not commit adultery. You've heard it said that those to those of old, you shall not commit adultery, but I say to you that whoever looks to a woman, at a woman to lust for her, has already committed adultery with her in his heart. And so as the Lord had done with the subject of murder and saying that even anger and the intent to harm another person in the heart was to violate that commandment, so if lust enters the heart and a desire for someone with whom we are not married, it gets engaged, then we are committing, we are violating that command that God gave to his people. We are committing adultery. And so we talked about reining in, taking steps to rein in lustful thoughts. We mentioned James chapter 4, where the apostle said, submit to God, therefore, resist the devil, and he will flee for you. We have to make some conscious decisions to recognize where the adversary is baiting us into looking and desiring relationships that are out of favor with the Lord. And at the very core of all this is the sacredness of marriage by God's design. I'll say more about that again today. That's one of the things that we have to do. That's part of the battleground that we face in this life. And there's no secret that there's all kinds of ways in which the adversary is trying to draw our attention into those areas where we desire relationships that are not ours to desire. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, I didn't mention this verse last week, but it would certainly fit here. And in many places in Scripture, the Apostle Paul urged the Christians at Corinth to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. So when we resist, we recognize we're being drawn into lust. We say, wait a minute, I'm gonna be obedient to Jesus. I need to capture that thought and take my thoughts somewhere else. And so today, we're going to shift to the second part of that same teaching on the matter of what it is to commit adultery, because Jesus says a little bit more. He's going to say furthermore on this particular subject. So we're going to talk about the subject of divorce. Now, I recognize that this is a very sensitive and can be a very emotional topic, especially for those who have gone through a divorce or have had a family member or a child go through divorce. Both my wife and I have siblings who have been divorced from spouses, and so we certainly saw firsthand some of the emotional and mental difficulties that they went through as they faced those situations. Of course, it's not only the parties involved in the divorce that can suffer, but so can children, and it can bring pain to extended family as well. So I recognize that this is a very sensitive subject, so I will try to speak as graciously as possible as we unpack what the Lord is saying to us here. The study won't be exhaustive. We're going to pretty much stick with what Jesus says here in Matthew chapter 5, but I do want to go to Matthew chapter 19, because Jesus affirms the very same things that he's saying here in Matthew 5, but it's part of a dialogue that he had between himself and a group of Jewish leaders. And so we're going to go to Matthew chapter 19. We'll pick it up at verse 3. Jesus had been in Galilee, and he's now come down to Judea, and a group of the Jewish religious leaders, the Pharisees, has come to question the Lord Jesus. Actually, let's read the Matthew passage first. Furthermore, it's been said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you, whoever divorces his wife for any reason, except sexual immorality, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a woman who is divorced commits adultery. And so Jesus is setting some parameters here for what constitutes adultery when a relationship is severed and a remarriage is considered or takes place. All right, but let's go to the Matthew passage. It says the Pharisees came to him, and here's their motive. He says they came to test him, testing him and saying to him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason? I'm going to pause there for a minute. We'll just kind of talk about the Pharisees for a second. They ask a question, and this is where their mindset is when they study the law, right? They're students of the Old Testament Mosaic law. They are well-versed in 613 commands, 248 do's, 365 don'ts. You know, they immersed themselves in that, and then they came up with interpretations of how that particular law would be kept. And I think it's fair to say that sometimes they tried to incorporate interpretations that gave them some leniency so that they could kind of do things the way that they wanted. But this particular command that they address with Jesus, is it lawful? So they're thinking law for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason. We need to go back to the book of Deuteronomy for a minute. And let's see the law to which they are referring in their inquiry. So if we go back to Deuteronomy chapter 24 in the first four verses, we read this. When a man takes a wife and marries her, and it happens that she finds no favor in his eyes because he has found some uncleanness in her, and he writes her a certificate of divorce, puts it in her hand, and sends her out of his house. When she has departed from the house and goes and becomes another man's wife, if the latter husband detests her and writes her a certificate of divorce, and I get two certificates, puts it in her hand and sends her out of his house, or if the latter husband dies who took her as his wife, then the former husband who divorced her must not take her back to be his wife after she has been defiled. Now you following this? For that is an abomination before the Lord, and you shall not bring sin into the land which the Lord your God has given you as an inheritance. So, let me try to simplify it as best I can. I get married to my wife. And after I get married to her, I find out there's something that's out of favor with me. There's something unclean. And to use Jesus' teaching, we're talking about a matter of sexual unfaithfulness. Then I have, according to Jewish law, I'm permitted to give her a certificate of divorce. Now, but in there, Jesus says, now if that woman goes and marries another man and he decides to issue her a certificate of divorce, or if he dies, she's not allowed to go back to the original spouse, which means if my wife were to go to marry someone else and that guy's not happy with her either for some reason, or there's been unfaithfulness, I can't have her back. Even if I wanted to, the Lord says no. And the Lord's pretty direct on this. You know, it's an abomination in the sight of the Lord. Why? Because as we established, and this is going to come out in our text today, marriage is sacred in the eyes of God. We become one flesh with our spouse. And if we go and we engage in something sexual with someone else, we have violated that sacred covenant. That's really kind of where this is going. But the Pharisees, being the way they are, want to see if they can trip Jesus up a little bit, test him to see what he has. Because there was two schools of thought in Jesus' day on the interpretation of this particular text. The first school was the school of a rabbi by the name of Shammai. And he was pretty conservative. He taught that divorce was only acceptable in the case of marital unfaithfulness. Kind of lines up with where the Lord was, right? All right. Think of Joseph and Mary. On learning of Mary's pregnancy, Joseph gave consideration. The scriptures, Matthew's very gracious, he says, to putting her away quietly. What he was looking to do was he could have given her a certificate of divorce, because he's working on the assumption she's pregnant, she's had some kind of sexual relationships, a relationship with someone that's not him. A violation of their betrothal, which in Jewish culture was about as binding as marriage itself, and so he's just going to put her away quietly so she didn't have to go through public shame. technically, according to the law, he could have her stoned. He wasn't going there, but you understand. So he says, this is something unclean. I have the legal right to put her away or to give her a certificate of divorce. Of course, the angel of the Lord intervened and made clear to Joseph that what was conceived in Mary was by the Holy Spirit, so that never took place. So that was the school of Shammai, only in the case of marital unfaithfulness. Now, there was a second school under a rabbi by the name of Hillel. He's a little more liberal in his interpretation. And so interpreting that phrase, let me go back a couple of verses. If it happens, she finds no favor in his eyes, or he has found some uncleanness in her, as some translations will say something displeasing, then if it wasn't just sexual impurity, and one pastor put it this way, you know, if the wife burnt the bagels, she's gone, right? He broadened the conditions. He broadened the allowances that would permit a man to give a certificate of divorce to his wife. And I can just imagine some of the men would have loved that school of thought, you know, and looking for an excuse to get out of the marriage, right? And so these were the two schools of thought. So in part, the Jewish leaders who questioned Jesus may have been seeking support for their preferred interpretation, because they were often looking for words by which they might accuse Jesus in his answers. But Jesus offers this response. He answered and said to them, "Have you not read that he who made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, 'For this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh.' So then they are no longer two, but one. Therefore what God has joined together, let no man separate." So notice, and we touched on this last week, so let's just comment on that again here. Jesus puts the sanction of approval on the original pattern in Genesis before sin entered the world. This is the ideal. This is the way God always designed marriage to be. One man and one woman in covenant relationship till death do you part. That's the way God designed it to be. But regrettably, sin entered the world. And sin in the human heart obviously changed man's outlook toward things, including putting him in a spirit of rebellion against God, even God's people themselves. So while we would agree with Jesus, and we as a congregation and as a people of God would always uphold the ideal, we also need to operate in the realm of a sinful, broken world, because divorce happens to Christian couples just as it does to non-Christian couples. Continuing in the text, "So they said to him, 'Why then did Moses command to give a certificate of divorce and to put her away?' And I love Jesus' response. And he said to them, 'Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts, permitted you.'" God didn't command divorce. He permitted you to divorce your wives. But, and notice where Jesus goes again, "from the beginning, it was not so. And so I say to you, whoever divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, and marries another, commits adultery. And whoever marries her who is divorced commits adultery." So above all, I want us to hold on to the pattern that Jesus is presenting. There's an ideal that is most pleasing in the sight of the Lord, that is sacred in the sight of the Lord. But given the fact that we live in a broken world, adultery happens. And it happens because of the sinful sexual desires in particular within a person's heart. Now let me throw this in here before we move on. For those who may not be aware of, in the Jewish context, there was undeniably a double standard. A man could divorce his wife, but a wife could not divorce her husband. That would certainly raise the ire of many in our secular society. But such was the culture of Israel. Women basically had no rights. They were subject to living in a male-dominated society. If you read Scripture, and especially in the life of Christ in the Gospels, you'll see, though, that Jesus gave far more dignity and value and worth to a woman than certainly the religious leaders did and the culture of his day. But again, Jesus affirms there is one exception that permits divorce and a certificate of divorce to be granted, which nullifies the view, by the way, that a man can divorce his wife under Jewish context. So he's answering the Jewish leaders, that a man can't divorce his wife and give her a certificate just for any old reason that he can come up with that falls within the boundaries of what he thinks is displeasing to him on the part of his wife. It's not a free-for-all. I can't just pick and choose. Jesus put some real restrictions on where divorce was permitted. And so he upholds the sacredness of marriage, the ideal, which, by the way, I think for us who are part of the church, it really illustrates our marriage relationship with our spouses, illustrates the union that we have as forgiven sinners with the Lord. Scripture depicts the church as the bride of Christ and Jesus as the bridegroom, right? We are bound forever in covenant relationship with our Lord and Savior. He demonstrated at the cross and by giving his life that he loved us incredibly deeply, and he is waiting now for the day that he's going to come back to take us all to be with him. Do you remember what Jesus said in John chapter 14? When he said to the disciples in the upper room, "In my Father's house are many mansions or many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." There's a depiction there that the disciples would have got. When a marriage couple, when they were betrothed to be married, it's a little stronger than an engagement, right? Engagements can be broken off in our day and age. But a betrothal was basically a binding agreement. You're going to be married. It's just the day of the fulfillment of that covenant, and the consummation of that covenant was yet to come. And so during that betrothal period, the groom would go and prepare the house that he was going to bring his bride to live in. And oftentimes in Jewish culture, it was a house that was part of his family's. They would put an addition on the house. So it might be semi-detached, it might be a fourplex, depending on how big the family was, and so he would be preparing that, and then when it was time for the official wedding to take place, he would go and bring his bride to his house, and they would live their lives together as a married couple for the duration of their days. Jesus is doing that for you right now, for you who believe. He's preparing your house, and then he's going to come get you, and he's going to take us there. But we are in covenant with him right now. It's a sacred covenant. That's why we need to live by kingdom values and kingdom principles, because we are a sacred people who belong to a holy Savior. And he has bound himself to us forever. We are not just his disciples. We are his bride. And that's a sacred relationship. And so our relationship with Jesus is reflected in our covenant relationship with our husbands and our wives. It is a union whereby we become one flesh and blessed in the sight of God. And again, that's the value of upholding the ideal that we're called to. And so that's what Jesus is really upholding, even though he's revealing how adultery can be committed to his audience, to the disciples in Matthew chapter 5 and to the Pharisees here in Matthew chapter 19, except for sexual immorality. A man commits adultery when he engages in a new relationship with someone who has previously been married and in a union with another partner. What we see in this particular teaching and in the part before it that we looked at last week, the sin of adultery is more than a physical act. It's a sin within the human heart. And that's the consistent teaching we're finding here in the Sermon on the Mount with Jesus and elsewhere that God is always looking at what's happening in the heart. I can commit adultery physically in a relationship, but I can also commit adultery by the very lust that I have in my heart. And really, it's sin in the heart that contributes to the breakdown of marital relationships, where couples reach a point where they feel like their differences are irreconcilable and they dissolve that relationship. I read some statistics from Canada that says over the past 20 years, divorces have increased every year for 20 straight years. In 2000, there was roughly 1.8 million divorces in Canada. It is in 2020, it was 2.7 million. Those numbers would probably be higher, except that there are more and more people cohabitating now. They're not even bothering to get married. And so, obviously, divorce is a common part of our society. And while the Bible makes it very clear that there's sin involved here, we as God's people need to let people know that divorce is not the unforgivable sin. It's a sin, absolutely. But so is anger that's inappropriate, right? So is stealing. So is dishonesty and deception. This is no different. And there is just as much room in the grace and the mercy and the love of God for people to find forgiveness who have gone through that painful experience of a divorce. And the church is intended to be a place where broken sinners find forgiveness and a second chance. They find grace. And the church should always be a place where even people who have gone through divorce find a place of grace and mercy. Jesus took you in, and he took me in. And we've all done things that separated us from the Lord. The church must be a place of grace as it was for us. There's certainly more that we could talk about this morning. And I have some things that perhaps as the Lord leads, we'll share on another time. But if we can just latch on to for today with these last two messages tied together, that marriage is a sacred union. That's really what Jesus was talking about. And he just illuminates that by saying, you have heard it said, you shall not commit adultery. But it's also a heart issue and not just an act that happens between two people. And it's the heart that Jesus is looking for his disciples to have changed and be different, to uphold and follow the values that he has laid down. Because he gave his life for us to save us. He left the glory and the riches and his position in heaven to come down and put on bodies like ours, prone to decay and suffering and pain and hardship and misery. He put this on for the purpose of going to the cross because he didn't want to see you and me separated from God for eternity. The love of Christ is incredible. And he did that so that our sins could be forgiven and we could be bound to him as his bride forevermore. Hold on to that above all in these teachings. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you again for bringing us together. Lord, we would do well to always make sure and be mindful that our hearts are always being examined by you. You look not only at the deeds that we do or the words that we say, but the attitudes and the intents that we carry. And it's these things that can only be changed by the indwelling of your Spirit and by our subjecting ourselves to his leading and his prompting and living in obedience to your word. I pray today that we will be a people who will cherish the ideal and uphold it in our own marriages, but also that we would have grace toward those who have been wounded and hurt because of a divorce, whether they knew the Lord or whether they didn't. Lord, they need to know that there's grace and mercy in the Lord and a chance to start again. And so, Father, may this kind of a heart always govern us here. So bless each heart and bless each home as we go from this place, and watch over us as we leave to serve and to represent you. Through Jesus we pray. Amen. Lord bless you, everybody. Have a wonderful day. I'll see you next week.